So happy to have amongst us Dr. Sanjay Manchanda, who is the chairman, senior consultant, Department of Sleep Medicine, Sir Gangaram Hospital, New Delhi. He's been practicing sleep medicine for the last 24 years and has to his credit more than 25,000 sleep studies. He's the first in the country to start sleep medicine as an independent department at Sir Gangaram Hospital. He's the first also to start home sleep studies. Another first to his credit is the treatment of snoring on an OPD basis with ENT surgeons. He was the first to start dental sleep medicine in India with orthodontist. He also developed the first mandibular advancement appliance for treatment of snoring and mild obstructive sleep apnea in India. Incidentally, he's also the first to start sound and music therapy for treatment of insomnia. And not the last, credit, excellence in developing sleep medicine by World Medical Council in 2016. Welcome, Dr. Sanjay Manchanda. We're so very honored to have you amidst us.
Thank you so very much. And I would like to, at the outset, I'd like to thank this Dignity Foundation and also Nareshi for having introduced me to it. And say, given me a chance to talk to all of you on my favorite subject, that is sleep, which is rather underestimated and is rather poorly understood. So in the next, say, around 35, 40 minutes, we are going to discuss about the various facets, whatever little we can, because it is a huge subject in itself. I'll try to be as non-medical as possible. But the thing is, being a person from the field of medicine, if there's anything, you can stop me in between, you can ask me, whatever you like, I'll go the same way. And it depends upon you. So I'm starting my presentation now. And that is, the first one, of course, is, you know, Reshaffen was the person who basically developed the sleep stages. So he was the person who gave a wonderful line about sleep, and that is that if sleep does not perform an absolutely vital function, then perhaps it is the biggest mistake of the evolutionary process that has been ever made. For the simple reason, life has taken 33%, nature has taken 33% of our lives, but that is not so. There is a reason behind it, and that is what precisely we are about to discuss. So what exactly is sleep? In the simplest possible term, this is a natural periodic suspension of consciousness during which the powers of the body are restored. So small but effective. So then when they say restoration, it means restoration of the physical and the mental restoration. It basically entering the information so that consolidation of memory is there, re-establishing communication between various parts of the brain, and time taken for the various kind of, say, repair systems, tissues that wear and tear occur during the daytime. So that is the function of sleep by and large. But it is still an unresolved riddle. It's an enigma kind of a thing. We still have to find our pieces into it. So let's see the commoner things and go into some details about one or two sleep disorders as well. As a society, we have a low priority for this subject. And on average, in last, say, 100 years, we are sleeping 20% less than our predecessors were sleeping. Precisely one major reason being the advent of artificial light. So as an individual, we are becoming a sleep-deprived society. There was a beautiful quote that you can fight many enemies and win, but if you try to fight your biology, you are likely to lose. So we can't fight the nature and our basic principles of biology because they are the essence of our own lives in a way. So first, let us see the importance of sleep deprivation. So is sleep really that very important? So these are the figures which were the past from United States, and we have a 4 times the population of United States. So there were more than 50,000 unnecessary deaths per year. There were countless injuries, disabilities, failures, and misery, accidental costs going on to $100 billion a year, and a healthcare cost of more than $200 billion a year. And you will see it in the say near this thing. There are the major accidents which have occurred because of sleep deprivation. The first is, of course, our own tragedy of Bhopal, that is 1984. 500,000 people were affected, 20,000 died, and loss of a huge amount of money as well. Second is basically the Chernobyl nuclear power plant disaster in Ukraine in 1986. 3.4 million people affected, half of them children. And this was the world's worst peacetime nuclear disaster. World's worst oil spill by the company Exxon, and it was seen that the cost was around $2 billion for the cleanup and $5 billion were fined to Exxon. And National Transport Safety Board of the United States, it calculated sleep deprivation as the cause of this disaster. In 1995, the Star cruise ship Princess had to be grounded in Alaska with more than 2,000 people on board. The vessel, where there was a damage to the bottom of the vessel and ruptured the oil tanks. The total cost of repair was $27 million. And the report was the pilot was chronically fatigued as a result of obstructive sleep apnea, which is related, of course, to snoring and sleep apnea. They go hand in hand. And which makes you feel tired and groggy during the daytime, or when you're functioning, you're not up to the mark. So ever since this 1995 disaster, they have made up a point that anybody who is carrying a larger number of the people or who are driving heavy vehicles, they should undergo a sleep study before really giving them the licenses to do so. Because it is not only their life at stake, it is a huge number of others' life also at stake. Well, this is a Red Rock overshoot. The pilot snoozed while landing, and there was a major accident killing 123 people all on board. This is something that we see every day in our lives, roadside accidents. The list is countless and it continues. But the importance is that not to show you the damages or to the show you these things, but a major question that could they have been prevented? The answer is yes, in large number of cases. So sleep basically is governed by the law of 1/3, because each of us spend almost 1/3 of our lives in sleeping, and 1/3 of the population at any given time suffers from some or the other sleep disorder. It could be sleep apnea, it could be insomnia, it could be narcolepsy, it could be restless leg syndrome, it could be sleepwalking, sleep talking, anything for that matter. And it will be interesting for all of you to know that there are more than 80 sleep disorders. So it's a huge subject in itself. And the major chunk is taken by insomnias and sleep-related breathing disorders, which include snoring, sleep apnea, and their damages, concomitant damages. Apart from that, there are narcolepsy, parasomnias like sleepwalking, sleep talking, sleep violence, and movement disorders. A very important thing associated with sleep would be the adequacy of sleep is a function of its duration, timing, and quality all put together. The thing is, even if you're sleeping for 8 hours and your quality of sleep is not correct, you will not feel healthy and fresh in the morning. So when we say duration, it may be 8 hours, 8.5 hours, okay. But there's another aspect is the timing. Timing, when we say it, is basically adhering to the rhythm. It could be half an hour up and down, that's not a problem. But it could not be like one day you want to sleep at 11 o'clock, other day you want to sleep at 2 o'clock. Your internal clock will have a lot of fluctuations and you may not be able to go into sleep. And third is the quality of sleep. When we say quality of sleep, it has 3 major facets. Basically the light sleep, the deep sleep, and the dreamy sleep. Ideally speaking, dreamy sleep should not be more than 15 to 20% of the total sleep time. But there are people who have got it around 30, 40, 50% of it taken into that. And that will ruin the deep form of sleep, which is basically the restorative period. So essentially, it is not just one that I sleep for 8 hours, why do I feel bad? if your quality of sleep is bad, if your timing is irregular, and if your duration is irregular. If all the three things, any of the limb is not functioning correctly, you're likely to have problems even after a good, even after apparently a good sleep. So let us just first say, give you two major disorders which have been associated, like snoring and sleep apnea. So Mark Twain once said, do not ever go to sleep. So many people die there. Now, the thing is, it may be a pun, it may be a kind of a, say, you know, an expression, but it was not too far away from the reality, because a large number of strokes occur in sleep, a large number of MIs occur in sleep, that is heart attacks, and a good amount of people do die in their sleep. So is there a reason, or is there something which we can say relate to? Let us see. We all know that smoking is injurious to health. It is about time that we realize that even snoring is injurious to health. Snoring would only occur if there is narrowing of the airways, and it is a sound generated by the soft parts of the palate, the tongue base, and by their vibration because of narrowing of the airways. So it's a whole continuum, actually speaking. It starts from mild snoring, goes on to chronic snoring, to heavy snoring, which goes on to an intermittent zone, which we call as upper airway resistance, where the patient has to breathe very hard to take the air in, and then comes the sleep apnea, which is the stoppages of breath during sleep. So apnea as a word means cessation of airflow, that is stoppage of breath. If it is for more than 10 seconds in duration and the frequency is greater than 5 events per hour, then it becomes pathological. The symptoms are so common that we are not even paying attention to it. Like snoring, a lot of people will still say that you are sleeping very well. The other ghode bech ke sote hain. But that is something which is not the truth. So snoring, which is coupled with excessive daytime sleepiness, fatigue, irritability, anxiety, depression, poor memory, poor concentration, increase of heartburn, especially during sleep, waking up with choking or gagging sensation, extreme restlessness in sleep, palpitations, etc. 6 to 8% of the population suffer with this disorder. So that means if we take India, there could be around 10 to 12 crore people suffering with this disorder. And the most important part is we are not even looking at the tip of an iceberg. So there's a huge amount of unrecognized disease under the surface, which needs to be unearthed and which needs to be recognized and treated. But these are the faces who are likely to have sleep apnea. The importance is, if you look at this one, obese people, we all say feel that they might be having snoring. But we, when we come to, they are normal people with smaller chin or receding chin, they are also likely to have sleep apnea. What exactly is happening in this is, that till the time we are awake, the muscles are in our control. We are breathing normally. The air is going in and out. The moment we sleep, muscles relax. And the tongue falls back, the palate goes down, and if there is narrowing of the airways, there's total stoppage, which is broken by the loud snort. So this happens to a person around hundreds of times in a single night, every night, night after night, and this is causing a huge amount of damage. So if untreated, the thing is today, with the advent, what started in 1980-81 as a kind of a small syndrome. Today, it is seen to get affecting all the systems of the body, right from pregnancy, where we can have premature births if the people are having snoring and sleep apnea. In neuropsychiatry, there could be strokes, depression, epilepsy, or impotency. In pediatrics, the children could be hyperactive, and they may have longer periods of bedwetting or aneurysis. In cardiology, it is one of the leading causes for high blood pressure, coronary artery disease, and cardiac rhythm problems. Socially, it is a nuisance. In the West, it is a cause for marital discord. And even in India now, the husband and wife are sleeping in different rooms if the space permits them. And apart from that, the newer entrants are cardiorespiratory failure, chronic kidney disease, type 2 diabetes, that is basically non-insulin dependent diabetes, and last but not the least, death during sleep. So it was labeled, the thing is, I'm just showing you this as an example, because this is the type of investigation we do on a sleep study. And you can see that these are the flatter areas where stoppage of breath is there. There's a sharp rise of, say, sympathetic nerve activity, or it increases the blood pressure both in the upper part and the lower part. That is, like we say, normal should be 120 by 80. It can touch up to 200 by, say, 120. And again and again and again and again in one night. So this kind of, you know, hemodynamic instability can cause a huge amount of damage. Heart failure cases, 40 to 50% have sleep apnea. Cardiac rhythm disorders, when you have heart blocks, especially during sleep, then these are also related to it. Another important aspect is strokes. Both the kind of strokes, that is basically, you can say, a thrombotic or embolic stroke, or which is because of, say, occlusion of an artery, or hemorrhagic stroke because of a high blood pressure. I'll just show you a small graphic on it. It might help you understand. The thing is, over here, if you see, the snoring occurs at this juncture, the maximum, where there is, these are main arteries which are going to the brain. And here, the maximum amount of, you can say, the plaques are there. Plaques means basically the deposits of fats. So if there's a shearing effect of, say, snoring, it can dislodge this embolus, which can go into a smaller part of the artery and can block the area, causing the stroke. Similarly, as we have already shown, that there are huge amount of blood pressure changes during sleep. If you can see over here, this is vibration due to narrowing of the airways, which culminates into stoppage of breath. As you can see, there is no movement. And the movement, it is broken. There's a sharp rise of blood pressure, like you're just about to witness. And this sharp rise can burst from the weaker part of the artery or the blood vessel, leading onto the brain hemorrhage, as we commonly call it.
Dr. Manchanda, I'm sorry to interrupt you, sir. We are still on the stroke slide.
Yeah.
Please check at your end. Are we still on the strokes slide?
Yeah, we are.
The slides have stopped. Yeah, yeah. Now we've gone on to prevalence of chronic kidney.
The thing is, and the later entries are basically the kidney failure. And in fact, the National Kidney Foundation, USA, has said that early detection of snoring and sleep apnea and its treatment can decrease the progression of the kidney disease and kidney failure. Another important aspect is obesity, that is weight gain and sleep apnea. A lot of people believe that obese people will have sleep apnea or will have snoring. But the fact is, anybody who has got narrowing of the airways because of the facial structure or the lower jaw structure, they are likely to happen to them. And in a way, they aggravate each other like a vicious circle. So the thing is, it basically boils down to two hormones which are there. One is called basically a satiety hormone, and the other is the one where you are feeling more hungry. That is ghrelin, and which increases in these kind of problems, and the person puts on more weight. So essentially, snoring and sleep, this obesity and sleep apnea, they are two sides of the same coin. Now, diabetes. So 50% of diabetes have sleep apnea, or snoring and sleep apnea. And if they are markedly obese, then it rises to around 86%. So where there are poor controls of blood, diabetes, and as a corollary, that if we treat these patients for their sleep disorder, the thing is, their blood glucose levels succumb into the normal zone, and they are able to reduce the HbA1c levels, which is a marker for long-term control over diabetes. So the relevance is that sleep apnea or snoring, this is a nearly 100% treatable condition. There are many ways, though, and it can be easily diagnosed by a sleep study, either which can be done in a hospital or at home of the patient. And the thing is, if there is only, you know, the lifestyle changes, so reduction in weight can help, but may not eliminate the disease. Avoidance of alcohol. So people who have snoring, they should try and avoid alcohol, especially at least 3 hours before the bedtime, because they will aggravate this problem. Unnecessary use of sedatives, tranquilizer, and hypnotics, that is the sleeping pills or resting pills, as they call it. So, and because in our country, they were say on the counter available kind of things, OTCs. So that is the problem, that you can get it easily. And the people know, everybody household knows that this is Zolfresh, this is this, this is compost. And everybody is ready to prescribe it to someone else very easily, but should be avoided. Now, the treatment, of course, is the most important treatment is basically a machine called CPAP. That is basically, it is an electronic or a computerized thing which passes the air through at a higher pressure and does not allow the structures to fall. So if there is a requirement, it changes the pressure continuously as per the requirement. So there are surgical things, but they're only for mild kind of things, except in children where the removal of large tonsil and adenoids can help. So surgeons are generally they are in hurry, and it should be avoided because you might need them later if you have removed the thing, which is not possible to get back. There are other devices like, say, lower jaw forwarding devices, which are available and which are custom made as well. Again, we have to choose our patients very carefully. Like here, we have many pathways, but we must choose them correctly. Now, another important aspect is insomnia, which is the most tarnished world as far as sleep is concerned. Because a lot of patients and a lot of people would come with this terminology, okay, I have insomnia. To them, insomnia means multiple things. Whereas actually, it's the word should have been dyssomnia, that is poor quality of sleep, and not the total sleep loss. So for patient, if the patient is not able to sleep, it is insomnia. If the patient is having a lot of tossing and turning, it is insomnia. If the patient is breaking their sleep a lot, it is insomnia. If, and there are times when the patient feels that patient is not sleeping, while their relatives would tell us that they are snoring also and they are sleeping. So this is called misperception of not having slept. So it is important to know, because every particular aspect has a specific medication. So one is that there is no blanket cover for insomnia. Insomnia is essentially a symptom and not a disease by itself of an underlying other sleep disorder, or by because of the medications taken for some other sleep disorders. So subjectively, it is basically a complaint which is difficulty in falling asleep, difficulty staying asleep, and poor quality of sleep, or inadequate or sleep, despite adequate opportunity. So there are many things which would occur. I've just said all of them, but there could be transient, which is short term, there could be long term. So we have to view them according to their duration. That if something is occurring more than 3 weeks in a row, there could be, you know, certain things are like a sudden accident, a sudden kind of a bereavement, then there could be a few days of this kind of a problem. But if it is occurring over a period of time, then we need to address it in a different manner. So I'll just basically skip this point for too much of a details. Now, another important aspect is the economic impact of sleep deprivation and sleep disorders in health system and your pocket. That is basically, a severely sleep deprived person can go from wide awake to fast asleep in less than 10 seconds. So there's a very poor margin of safety. As you can see in this graphic, all that you need is a snooze on the wheel and drowsiness is there and it could last for eternity. So there was a major study which was conducted. This was in Australia. In 1 year only, there were more than 800,000 roadside industrial accidents. And the cost incurred was around, say, $16 billion with 1,400 lives. And the treatment and diagnosis would have cost a very small fraction of it. So it is important for all of us to understand that sleep is something where we should not take it lightly. And the treatment has reversed that trend of, say, healthcare utilization for the government as well as for individuals. So there are direct costs and there are indirect costs. So it was actually being found out that it is only the 2% of the total cost that we bear for the treatment and diagnosis. And it suggests that we are paying a bit too much for, because if you are having a stroke, if you are having a heart attack, if you are having, say, roadside industrial accidents, you spend a huge amount of money with lifetime debility. Whereas if even in 25% cases, it can be prevented, it can be of a great help, and the quality of life of a person will improve tremendously. So other conditions, apart from diabetes, which we have mentioned, 25% of the patients, they exhibit some form of depression. Sleep disordered, breathing and accidents, injury from motor vehicle or accident, 7.2 times, that is 720 times higher than the normal ones. There is a problem with the heart at all the levels, high blood pressure, cardiac heart failure, and say cerebrovascular accidents. Now coming on to sleep disorders and basically myths attached to it. We have our own kind of say derivations that we tell ourselves. So first is, sleep is not always equal to rest, and sleep medicine is not just insomnia and snoring and sleep apnea. There are more than 80 sleep disorders which need to be understood and need to be treated correctly. A lot of people feel that a glass of a beer or a wine before sleep would help you into sleep. The fact is, while nightcap may seem relaxing, but it has got a REM rebound, that is basically a dreamy state which goes into a very high level. And as a result, what happens is you become slowly dependent on it, that at least some amount of sleep is occurring. But this is no treatment. And if you are having a sleep disorder, avoid this. Second is, insomnia is characterized only by difficult falling asleep. As I have told, it is insomnia of sleep onset, maintenance, and not having felt better even after sleeping. People feel that they are difficult disorders to be, say, treat and diagnose. They are rather easy to, you know, easily diagnosed and can be treated with a full night polysomnography, or that is a sleep study in the hospital or at your homes. So we can do the home monitoring as well. Now, very major important aspects will be that the myth is that I have learned not to sleep as much. A lot of people would be telling you, okay, I can sleep 5 hours and I'm very, very active thereafter. The fact is that sleep needs are genetically determined and cannot be changed. Although performance of the tasks, they can improve somewhat with effort, but optimal performance and consistency of that performance will not be. Another important myth is that I can tell how tired I am, and I know when I'm not functioning at par. This is something which is a way wrong kind of a thing. The fact is, studies have shown that sleepy people underestimate their level of sleepiness and overestimate their alertness. So when I said that it takes you only 10 seconds from wide awake to deep asleep, so that is the thin margin of safety. And the more sleepy you are, the less accurate your perceptions are. So as a country, if you think that 32% of the Americans, they are having sleep deprivation, 1/5 of the population of UK, 17% of the Finnish population, 21% of the Polish population, 11% of the Australian population, they have the sleep disorders and they have reduced times of sleeping. Now, considering India, we are heading much more than what Americans are doing, for the simple reason we are also the world capital for call centers. So our young children are exposed to the nighttime working far more than these people are. They are getting their job done from us. And as a result, and more importantly, the day sleep is never as fulfilling as the night sleep, because everybody else is on an activity mode. Well, the thing is, I'm taking you away from the sleep disorders to some funny and spooky things that have happened in sleep around the world. And they have been recorded one. So one is basically, these are parasomnias, where we call it sleepwalking, sleep talking, and sleep violence and all those things. So somnolency is sleeping, is speaking in sleep. So it is not much of an issue, but some problems arise when there's intelligible somnolencies which fall upon the wrong ears. In 2006, a Muslim couple was ordered to separate when the husband allegedly uttered talaq thrice in the sleep. This has happened, actually. This is not something which is a hearsay. Another important thing is a person jumping off. I have had around 4 or 5 such kind of cases where people have jumped from the first floor or the second floor during sleep without their knowledge. But ironically, the damages are lesser as compared to when you're awake and you fall. Because when you're awake, you make your muscles very stiffened up. In sleep, you are totally relaxed. So the absorbing capacity of the body is much better. But that doesn't, take you away from the fact that people can get themselves damaged or somebody else. So there was a case, this was basically recorded again. Then drunk texting. This is something which was very interesting, which was reported in 2008 in Ohio University, where a 44-year-old woman, she came out of the bed, logged onto the internet, and invited people for the meal, and also asked them to bring certain things. And this was all done in sleep, where she was not aware of it in the morning. So now this is another important thing. Rosenthal was a person, and this was from University of Pennsylvania, where this person had passion of sleepwalker for a long, long time. And his nighttime antics, he was also a music lover. And he would become a full musician in the night and would basically also, vocalize the sounds of the instruments during that period, and may find himself in stranger places, which was just very embarrassing for him. Here's was a head nurse, a nurse in Hadwin, which was basically a person who used to become a painter during sleep. 60 to 90 minutes of very strong painting strokes. And by his own admission, he had his interview in BBC. By his own admission, if I want to drive or sketch something, I will not be able to do it in my wakefulness. And perhaps he also said that he doesn't have great interest in painting. So he again had this kind of a problem. Now coming to alcohol, the thing is, if you are awake for 18 hours in a sustained wakefulness, your performance is as bad as a drunk person. Moderate sleep apnea produces the performance impaired greater than that of a drunk performance. And if you are sleeping 4 hours for six nights a day, you can have a lot of problems and you can hit an accident and you can drive. Now, there's another thing that was there. I'll just like to mention, because this question was asked to me by the police chief of Assam. He gave me a call that you are a sleep specialist. Have you come across anybody who has, murdered a person during sleep? So it was not a film kind of a situation, but it was an actual situation. I said, I personally do not have, but we can look into the literature. So we found a few cases where the patients had driven down in sleep, murdered a person, surrendered next day to the police station, because they had cut their own hands as well in sleep. They never knew about it. And some people used it as an alibi, and they were caught because there were a lot of inconsistency. The first case of them was was left because he had a history and he had no motives. So basically, the problem is that sleep, if you do not know about the sleep, ignorance about the sleep is the worst sleep disorder of them all. That if you do not know, you will not even look into it. But there's a reason, because there's a smaller number of practitioners, there's a late start to the scientific and the clinical discipline, and teaching about sleep is almost totally absent from the mainstream educational system. And more importantly, we do not give any kind of importance to our sleep. So sleep is basically a human right, recognized or not. It is crucial to the health, well-being, and social functioning. Thomas Edison, when he created a bulb, he did not realize that he is going to revolutionize the total world for all times to come, because today we are a 24-hour society. So we never know. The nature was very kind to give us a day and a night, day to work and night to sleep. But today we have converted into this kind of a phenomenon where everything is working at all the times. And if we are having this kind of a problem, like with the shift workers and people who are having a lot of work in the call centers, so there are symptoms which start occurring they have more digestive problems because the acid releases occur at a different kind of time. They are more susceptible to heart diseases and the stress because in the daytime they do not get as much quality of good sleep as they would get in the night. Obesity increases. The GI problems would be a lot of them, like loss of appetite, constipation, acid release, and heartburns. And apart from that, cardiac, we have already told you. There's hypertension, which is one of the biggest cause, sleep disorders are one of the biggest causes for high blood pressure. In fact, the number one single cause. Apart from that, there are certain cancers which have had shown high risk in patients who are sleeping less or wrongly. That is colorectal cancers, that is the cancers of the intestine. Again, because of the total imbalance of hormones which are being secreted in day and night. The shorter durations have increased, then the breast cancer has been now been attributed to this kind of a thing. The recent studies have also shown that you have a poor quality of cognition or basically imbibing. And there is, say, a lot of people feel that, you know, the caffeine is something with which we can keep awake, but to a level only. And again, if you are, even if you are driving and you want to have a sip of a coffee, thinking that we will be able to drive through, you may not be able to. The most important points now for the sleep hygiene. Hygiene means basically like we clean our body. So we need to clean our sleep methods as well. One is go to bed only when you are sleepy. So associate your bed with sleep. The thing is, don't go to bed to sleep because bed is not a sleeping pill. There should be a common get-up time so that your cycles do not suffer. Even if you have slept at 11 or 1, you should get up at a common time, because if you laze around longer, your internal clock will shift. Remove the clock if you are not feeling sleepy from your bedroom, because it will be a second habit to look at the clock for every time to time, increasing more anxiety. Switch off your mobile phones at bedtime, especially if you are in a service where you do not have emergencies. Switch off your television half an hour before your bedtime. Take a lighter meal in the dinner. Avoid alcohol 3 to 4 hours before bedtime, because otherwise it will cause a lot of regurgitation and may cause a lot of acidity. Avoid tea or coffee. They are stimulants, so avoid them. That is only for people who are having a problem of sleep. If you don't have, you can do whatever you feel like. But if you have the problem, then adhere to these things. And a warm shower, which basically will help you relax the body. So chronology, I just said. So they say that you can't stop the idea whose time has come. Time has been there for a longer time, but I think that we all need to think collectively about this aspect. And remember that there are only two ways, and two ways only, that a person can become sleep deprived. One is reduced daily amount of sleep, which is more because of your occupational workout, and excessively interruptions due to sleep disorders, which we need to work on. This we have said. So today we are a 24-hour society. Strategies for improving peak human performance must involve a sensible awareness of human limits. Systems and procedures must be designed to play up to the human strengths rather than weaken them up. There is a basic conflict between the biological imperative for sleep and social demand for performance. This poses a fundamental question to all of us. What happens to the performance when the pressure of sleep is increasing? So are we really doing justice to ourselves by doing so? So we do all have an internal clock, and it gets set in a particular manner when we are using it. But if we are disturbing it a bit too much, the internal clock, as you can see over here, may not remain the same as the external clock. So to take home message would be, the sleep, sleepiness, and performance are inextricably bound up with each other. Sleep debt is like a lava, and it can explode anytime. Sleep is a basic human right, recognized or not. It is a crucial thing for the health, well-being, and functioning. Sleep is a form of a learned behavior involving complex interplay of biology, psychology, and cultural factors. Unfortunately, sleep is underrepresented at the national health agendas, despite the availability of a wide range of proven cost-effective interventions. and priority intervention should increase more of public dissipation of the knowledge. So nearly half a century of huge reservoir of knowledge about sleep, sleep deprivation, and sleep disorders has been building up behind a dam of pervasive ignorance. We do not know how many tragedies are occurring right now, this moment. Either we should lower down the floodgates or blow up the dam. The challenge is that we must change the way society deals with sleep. The opportunity is that the human race will be lifted to a new level of energy, health, and safety if we take it seriously. And last, I always finish with the Robert Frost's famous line, that woods are lovely, dark and deep, and I have some promises to keep, and miles to go before I sleep, and miles to go before I sleep. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for the patient hearing, and because you are being blocked. So any amount of questions that you need to talk or work on, and they're welcome.
Thank you, Dr. Manchanda. This actually was on a beautiful note. This is one of my favorite poems as well. And I'm sure a lot of our members have also heard this. Beautiful insights into the causes and the relationship of other illnesses with diseases. Thank you so much. We had no idea what vast a topic sleep is. And before I go into questions, I would request our members to kindly put their questions in the chat if you still have some, or please raise your hand, even if it means raising your physical hand, and introduce yourself when your name is called out before you ask your question. Thank you. So I begin with the first question in the chat. It's been asked by Mr. Kasi Viswanathan from Chennai, and his question is, my question, what do you mean by quality of sleep? Please elaborate.
Look, the thing is, when I say the quality of sleep, when I said that it is one of the pillars of sleep, it is, we have got a sleep architecture, that is, which includes the light sleep, the deep sleep, and the dreamy sleep. The dreamy sleep should not be more than, say, around 15 to 20% of the total sleep time. And if it basically increases, then it takes away the part of the deeper form of the sleep, which is basically a sleep required for the growth in children and for the repair of the body tissues in adults. Like if you had 100 rupee and you had earmarked, say, 20 rupees for a particular thing, but you had to spend 40 rupees for the same, you already had only 100 rupees. So you will compromise on something else now. So the quality of sleep means that there has to be a kind of a correct rhythm, and there has to be a correct distribution of those sleep stages so that the person rises fresh and the functions are, say, helped, basically.
Thank you, Dr. Manchanda. Mr. Kasi Viswanathan, I hope that answers your query. We'll go on now to a question from Kolkata, Rita Bose. At the age of 70 plus, do we still need 8 hours of sleep?
70 plus, first thing to realize is that if a person, generally, you know, you're talking of people who have retired around, 5 to 7 years prior to this. So 70 plus, the thing is, normally it has been seen that we get more of a fragmented sleep. And if we are not adhering to a particular norm, that is, if we are not working, we have left any kind of work, the work discipline is not there. So you will keep on having a sleep here and there, 15 minutes nap, half an hour naps. And the thing is, it consolidates to a complete level. Having a consolidated 8 hour sleep may or may not be there, but the body takes its share out of it. And yes, you do have a slightly lighter kind of sleep at this age, if you're not functioning. If you have a timetable kind of a thing that you still have to go to office, or you have taken up a job, or you have basically, maybe even in some philanthropic work or otherwise, if you have a kind of a, say, structured thing, then the problem of sleep would not be there as much. But in case if you're at home all the time, it's all the time is available to you, then you will have the scattered amount of sleep. Eventually, it may add up to 8, 7, 9 hours. That depends basically from person to person.
Right. Thank you. Moving on to the next question. Dr. Manchanda, somebody wants to know, are you available for video consultation? And if yes, how do we go about it?
There are actually three ways of video consultation that are available. One is that you can take a direct appointment from the hospital, Sarvangaram Hospital, and for the video consultation, you pay in advance over there. And then the thing is, we get the timing and we can tell our patient when I will be available. You open up a, say, chat on WhatsApp or phone, and we can discuss the details. The second is, we have a site of our own, what is called as My Follow Up. My Follow Up.
Okay.
MYFOLLOWUP.
Okay.
So there is a site which we have designed for, especially for the people who are outside Delhi and who want to, say, talk to us. So they can load their previous prescriptions also. They can load their reports also. And we can have a video chat with them. And we can send the prescription on the same format. So you have to get registered on that site as a patient. And the money has to be deposited. But money only will be cut once the prescription has reached you. And third is, some people like who are in Nepal or otherwise, these people, they take down my bank account, say, number, and transfer the money directly, and we can have a video chat. So all these three are possible.
Thank you, doctor. Our next question is from Nagaraj SR. In which posture will you get good sleep, and how to get fast sleep?
Look, first thing is, there is nothing as a fast sleep. Sleep will occur in its own time. The importance is that if you are waiting for sleep to come in the bed, it is a bad kind of a thinking process. You wait outside the bed, you go to the bed when you are feeling sleepy. That is the most important issue that I told you in the hygiene of the sleep also. Because the thing is, everybody has got a different, and as far as the posture is concerned, nature is very kind. It takes you to a posture of maximum comfort by itself. People who snore, they generally, you know, lie on their belly, because at least some amount of tongue will come forward, some airways would be there. So there is no fixed kind of a thing that which posture will get you good sleep. The posture will be decided by nature itself, and there is no fixed posture which is going to give you a good kind of a sleep.
Thank you, doctor. Moving on. Mr. R.P. Sahu wishes to know, is it okay to sleep if sleep is scattered during day and night, and what are the requirements of sleep for older people?
That is what I said when the question was there for the 78-year-old gentleman. That is basically, if you are not working and you are remaining at home, the scattered sleep only occurs because you are not organized into a particular kind of a rhythm. So when you have all the time in the world, you can just go and lie down anytime. So the thing is, that is where you will get your scattered sleep. And nature is something which will take care of itself, because whatever is the requirement, it will fulfill. The only thing is, if it is kind of a thing where you are having a scattered one, people might still be asleep when you would be awake. So you have to find yourself some kind of a thing, whether you go for some kind of a mild yoga, pranayam, or any kind of a healthy thing, so that you remain well. That is more important. Because if you are still working, elderly means, you know, there's a huge range today. Elderly is not at 58 or 60. Today it ranges up to 75% people are, you know. So if you're functional and you have to go to an office or some kind of a commitment, then you will sleep in a proper manner and get up in a proper manner.
Right. Thank you. Mr. Kiran Mahankale has requested from Pune to share the tips of sleep once again, if possible.
Sure.
You could just mention a few of them if you'd like to.
Yeah. The thing is, the first one, of course, is go to bed when you're feeling sleepy. Don't try to, your bed should associate with sleep. So don't lie on the bed that it is 11 o'clock, so I should try and sleep. No. Till then, you can sit in some very comfortable couch, or maybe listen to a very mild instrumental music a very light reading which is not engrossing. You could, and when you feel your eyelids are saying, okay, now I'm feeling a bit sleepy, then you go to the bed. Second is, no matter what time you sleep, your get-up time should be common, so that we should not allow your clock to drift. Otherwise, what will happen is that, okay, I slept at 1, I should sleep till 9 today. That will basically change the whole scene, and slowly that will become your new norm. So don't allow that to happen. Third is that if you are sleepless, or you are feeling that you don't get good quality of sleep and you are awake for a longer time, then remove any clock that you are having for in your bedroom, for the simple reason when others are sleeping and you are awake, it will be a second kind of a nature to you to look into the clock every 10 minutes or 15 minutes, which will create a negative feedback cycle. Third is, remove, your phones should be charging in some other room, because the smallest tinkle is a sleep breaker. And the moment you want to open it, the bright light that comes, we call it blue light. It basically has the same wavelength as that of sun. So it makes you feel it is day. Again, it will disrupt your sleep in a big way. Third is that if you are watching television, there is a tendency that even if we are feeling sleepy, we say, okay, this will end in 20 minutes. Let me see this good program. So the thing is, next cycle would come after, say, around 1.5 hours or so. So you'll again feel distressed about it. Okay, the thing is, okay, abhi toh I was getting the sleep and now I'm not getting the sleep anymore. So don't avoid it. Stop it to at least 30 minutes your requisite time, or whenever you have decided that this should be my sleeping time. So half an hour before that, shut down your TV. Then do not take any caffeinated drink or coffee or tea after 7 p.m. Because the thing is, these are stimulants, or smoking for that matter. They are all stimulants. So they will basically invigorate you, and you will be more alert and active rather than going to the sleep. So avoid that. Alcohol should not be used as a tool for sleeping. And it should be around, say, minimum of 3 hours before your bedtime. And apart from that, the exercises should be done in the morning hours and not in the evening hours. This is for the younger lot, basically, who hit the gyms in the evening, because it disrupts the sleep totally. For sleeping, you need a relaxed body, not a tired body. So this should not be done. And finally, a warm shower will always help you go into sleep much better. Archana ji, your mic is closed. Yeah.
Yes, thank you so much. So there's somebody who has specifically asked about a sleeping pill, Alprazolam, and said that this is something that's been recommended by her doctor. Unfortunately, she's still not getting enough sleep. So is this the safest medicine to take for sleep?
No. First thing is, Alprazolam or any kind of sedatives should not be prescribed unless and until you have diagnosed the case. Because if it is because of some severe anxiety occurring that particular night, maybe some fight, maybe some kind of, say, a bad thing happened in the family, then you can take it as a tranquilizing effect. But it should not be a treatment for, say, insomnia or not being able to sleep. You need to first understand what problem you are suffering from, and then you take the medication. You cannot take the medication just because, keep on increasing the dosages of that. That is the wrong way of treatment.
Right. Reasons for not getting proper sleep in old age. I'm sure a lot of our members want to know this.
Well, the perception of not having slept is a totally different kind of a phenomenon. The thing is, in the daytime also, you have taken shorter naps without your knowledge sometimes, and with your knowledge sometimes. So the collective importance is that, okay, you will not be giving a consolidated sleep in the night. The thing is, more or less, the difference occurs only around 10 to 15% of the total one. If you don't have a commitment the next day, you let yourself a bit loose. As I have told you already in two questions, The thing is, it is only your discipline for the day which can prevent you from having those kind of, say, problems with your sleep. Apart from that, yes, there are other things which might have crept in or may have enhanced during this period. And for that, you need to discuss this at length, because there's a good amount of questionnaire to understand what exactly is your problem. Some people have got basically twitchy kind of a sensation in their legs. This we call it restless leg syndrome. And, you know, these people have restlessness in the legs much more while lying down than in the waking up. In fact, waking up eases it out. So when those flickers are occurring, it does not allow, even if you are feeling sleepy, it does not allow you to sleep. So as a result, the thing is, you first need to understand what is the...
So we've lost you. Dr. Manchanda. Unfortunately, we are not able to get Dr. Manchanda back. If you can just allow me a couple of... Yes, I believe Dr. Manchanda had lost connectivity. Just allow us a minute before he returns. Dr. Manchanda, if you're there back with us, please continue.
Because actually there was some problem with the electricity suddenly, so that's fine.
I'm glad you're back, sir. So I'm sorry, should we continue with the next question? I know we've gone beyond our time limit, but there seem to be quite a few questions coming in.
No problem.
I'll just take a few more, sir.
Sure.
So somebody wants to know that they go to bed by 10 p.m. and most days they're able to fall asleep quite fast. But certain days, even after 3 hours, they're not able to fall asleep. So what is the recommended action? Do they need to get up 4 to 5 times, or how do they sleep under the circumstances?
The thing is, that is where the importance of sleep study comes. If that has been happening for a longer period of time, we need to understand what sleep disorder you are suffering from and accordingly tweak the case. Because for right kind of say treatment, you need a right kind of diagnosis. And with more than 80 sleep disorders, you cannot just have a small one group of things being prescribed to you for that kind of a thing. So if it has been occurring for more than, say, 3 months, 2 months, 1 month, then you need to talk first to somebody, try to understand, and he should also understand as to what kind of disorder you're suffering. And then we can treat you with a much milder kind of a medication, because it is much more targeted. Instead of a cluster bombing, we can go for laser bombing, which is rather precise, without just putting on all kind of sedatives and antidepressants. That should not be done, unless and until it has been proved beyond doubt that you have a problem.
Right. Thank you, doctor. A very interesting question has come up. We are conditioned to certain hours of sleep daily. Does it become affected when we travel across time zones?
Yeah, it does. Jet lag is one of the most important kind of, sleep disorders in present day world, where people are moving across the, time zones. The thing is, there are areas where there is a longer sun there are areas where they have ultra short kind of this thing. Like if you go to Finland around or Scandic countries, the thing is there are days when it is 23, 24 hours of days. And they all use triple curtains to use it. Plus, apart from that, the time zones, when you fly back to east, they are much more, say, badly affected than when they go to the westwards. But the thing is, that will always be there. And internal clock, has a problem. Normally, we give a thing what we call as melatonin for that. For the simple reason, this is a resetter of your internal. This is a normal hormone which is secreted during darkness by pineal glands for sleeping. The thing is, so we supplement them with this kind of a thing so that they can get into order easily. And time zone movements definitely affect the sleep.
Thank you, sir. This is really the very, very last question, because we are aware that it's already been an hour that you've been speaking, and we are really, really grateful. On a lighter note, how is it that the person snoring are not aware that they are snoring?
Well, of course, that is why we need the detailed history from the partner as well. When you ask a person, do you sleep a lot? No, I'm fine. The person tells us, no, we need to keep on sleeping even in the car. Then, the thing is, there are times when you're not aware of yourself. And because it's not something that you're telling a lie, but it is something which you're not really aware of yourself. So, and more so if the partner has already slept and you're not sleeping, or even if we are sleeping, so there are a lot of variations would occur, which you will not be aware. That is why we do a sleep study. If everything could have been told us in advance, we would not have needed a sleep study.
That's right. And that's where the role of sleep specialists like you comes in. Thank you, Dr. Sanjay Manchanda. We learned so much from you today. And I, for a fact, know of a couple of instances where I was sleep deprived and dozed off while driving. Thankfully, I'm still alive. And I would request our members to take pay equal attention to their sleep quality, not deprive themselves by viewing too much of TV, or for that matter, not having, things which don't work for them just before they're sleeping, whether it be activity or food or even drinks. So on that note, I would take permission from Dr. Sanjay Manchanda to sign off. And thank you so much once again, Dr. Manchanda. Okay. We have been honored with your presence, and hopefully we'll be seeing more of you in the future. Thank you so much, members. We've had a very, very nice day today, and hope you have a great weekend. Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye.
Thank you.